so sorry for the smoke. Promise the place isn't burning to the ground. It just turned a perfectly good barley loaf into a lump of coal is all. Oh, it's you. This is embarrassing. I hate to tarnish my spotless baking reputation. I can assure you everything was going exactly according to plan until those meddling meadlings got involved. Never heard of them. I guess they must be native to Harbington. At first, I thought we had mice. Common assumption when it comes to meadlings, you'll hear them scuttling about. But the difference is, you'll also hear them bickering amongst themselves. They're quite argumentative, so you'll hear a chorus of tiny, overlapping mutterings. But once they've settled the necessary grievances, they also quite like to sing together. Not well, mind you, but I think that just adds to the charm. They sound sort of like a choir, entirely composed of confused children who've lost their mother at the marketplace. It's quite sweet, actually, to hear those many different small voices coming from all directions, some deeper, some sweeter, from around the corner, under the table, behind the door. Remember, I'm no artist, but I am going to try to sketch one for you, just so you can have a better idea of what to imagine. And more importantly, you'll know one if you see it. I know I've got paper around here somewhere. They spend their whole lives wandering from garden to garden in search of cats. Yes, cats. The only way that meadlings are able to enter a home is if they are carried in by the household's cat. They can live just fine on the garden, but they long for the warmth and wonder of the great indoors. They're quite curious by nature and will fiddle with please. A simple, tidy home is their worst nightmare. They're drawn to clutter and love nothing more than ransacking, rummaging, and rearranging every little thing that catches their eye. It's never malicious, but there we are. Sweet little buggers, aren't they? They seem to have taken an interest in my ingredients last night and took it upon themselves to spice up the arrangement. Let's see if I can get these the basil's makeup. ginger. That explains it. When I thought I was adding a dash of nutmeg, I was actually blessing my bread with a healthy dose of spontaneous combustion powder. Oh, you'd be surprised. It comes in handy quite often. They know they have to be, since if you manage to catch a glimpse of one in a puff of purple smoke, it will be instantly transported back into the garden and never again able to pass through your door. It all started when they took a liking to Pepper. She loves sunbathing in that garden, settling herself amongst the crawled right on board, tucking themselves away in the fluffy tufts of her fur. She would have been far too pleased with all the attention to object. You've destroyed us, Pepper. You've brought us to ruins. Have you no remorse? She's purring. I think she's quite pleased with herself. That'll have to do for now. Better get a fresh barley batch going. I know it won't be a moment before they're asking for another loaf downstairs. It was very popular. I use my grandma's special recipe with honey and ale. Gives it that earthiness. Sometimes I'll even throw in a handful of walnuts to make it a bit heartier. But don't you be going around telling the whole town about that. I'll also try fixing up a batch of sizzled apples. I've never made them before, but Pippa Whistle lent me her recipe. She always used to make them for me when I was little. With all the sweetness and spice, they fill the entire place with the best smell. I think they'd make a very comforting treat for any guests feeling homesick. Okay. only uses handwriting this nice for her recipe pages. Otherwise, it's entirely illegible. Calls for 5 perfect apples, 2 dashes of brown sugar, 1 splash of vanilla, 3 sprinkles of cinnamon, 1.5 pinches of nutmeg, drop of honey or ale, depending upon what the particular night calls for, I suppose. Quite simple steps. Slice apples, brush with spiced glaze, bake until the kitchen smells of home. See, here we've got our overflowing basket. Calls for perfect apples and nothing less. Thankfully, we just had a basket of Royal Envies delivered from Falkirk. They're crisp and sweet, perfect amount of tang, definitely the best variety for making cider, and will suit this recipe very nicely. When Pippet Whistle used to make this for me, she always used freckled golden hours because she had the most beautiful tree full of them growing right outside the shop. I spent most of my childhood at the moss drop, actually. My parents started showing me the ropes of running the inn when I was a teenager, but as a kid, I was more trouble than I was worth. I can't blame them. I was always breaking plates, pestering guests with too many nosy inquiries. I used to run up to ogres, tuck on their pants leg, ask them why their ears were so big and if that meant they could hear the flowers growing. But Pippet Whistle didn't mind my antics. In fact, she thought they suited the moss drop. She always likes to keep that place lively, and I certainly provided more than enough excitement. I mostly liked to sit in the back, watching her bustling about, dancing and singing to herself as she brewed and baked. Oh, and of course I was selflessly carrying out my duties as official taste tester. Oh yes, sacrifices must be made. But I also really love to wander around the tables, admiring all the guests. Every sort you can imagine. Curly mustached gentlemen in top hats, bloodstained bandits, extravagantly adorned duchesses, tattered hobgoblins, all huddling together in one cozy little room. Anyway, more than enough about me. How have you been? I feel like it's been ages since I've seen you. I imagine you've been quite busy making the rounds about town, preparing for your grand departure. Oh, I'm jealous. Visiting Clover is always a dream. I swear that greenhouse is like an entire world of its own. As soon as I step through those stairs, it must be all of the love and attention she pours into nurturing those plants. It radiates back out tenfold. I imagine she piled your arms a mile high with gifts. She's quite the generous type. Always likes to give new visitors a warm welcome and hopes they'll be back. That greenhouse is gorgeous. Easy feat making the journey out all the rain, those already narrow paths get so overgrown, even a field mouse would struggle to find his way through. She must get lonely. I suppose the type of people who devote themselves that fully to their work most often are. Back in the summertime, she sent me the most beautiful basket for my birthday, filled to the brim with the loveliest herbs, spices, blossoms, and no shortage of seed packets. I think my favorite had to be the warlock's vine. It grew like wild, I swear. I blinked and it had unfurled itself throughout the entire under tables, through chairs, over windowsills, filling the air with that wonderful aroma. Clover said that it'll smell like the nurturer's most treasured scent in all the world, right? I can't quite place mine. I'll bring it down from the perch. Maybe you'll be able to make some sense of it. Here she is, the beauty herself. Incredibly vibrant, isn't it? Alright, why don't you have a whiff? Let me know what you think. Nightshade shop? Really? No, is it really so obvious? You got that in a moment. Unmistakable. Well, anyway. Well, I see you've managed to tear your coat up yet again. I'm starting to wonder if you get yourself. You just like being fussed over. No matter. It's a good thing I like to fuss. Come in here. Oh, goodness. This is the worst you've done yet. I'll try my best to patch things up for you. A simple end up looking like a bit of a ragamuffin by the time I'm through, but at least the wind won't get to you so much. See, I keep this basket handy, tucking away any spare bits and bobs for times like these. Whenever fights break out downstairs, there's always a mess left behind. All left strewn across the floor. When the night is through and all those drunken fools have all stumbled back to their beds, I tiptoe downstairs, armed with my basket and my broom. There's candlelight glinting off the glasses. The bard likes to stick around a while, and instead of the vigorous shanties he's been shouting, he softens to a slow, lolling tune, plucking away at the strings and gently humming. It's my favorite time of night. After a long day of hustle and bustle, finding comfort in the thought that the day is done, you've done all you can do, and now it's time. voices and footsteps outside, crisp crackle embers in the fireplace. Well, I straighten up the tables, polish up the glasses, sweep the floors, everything good as new. Right, well, I'm trying my best, but I surely can't say it's looking seamless. I hate to add yet another stop to your already elaborate plan. You'll stand out and not in a favorable way. She'll be more than happy to tailor a gorgeous outfit, fitting of one counseling with the queen. She'll be over the moon that her work will be seen by so many important figures. And hopefully she'll also be able to advise you on matters of etiquette. I wish I could help you there, but I just don't have the same familiarity. All I know is that people in the kingdom can be quite finicky and, dare I say, stuck up. Many subtleties and unspoken rules. It's easy to gravely offend without meaning to. All a bit silly and superficial, if you ask me, but I do understand that tradition is tradition. Not everyone can be so unceremonious. It doesn't happen often because this place is far, far beneath their standards. But every once in a while, a traveling noble has their carriage raided, caught in a storm, stuck in the mud, some other sort of trouble. And they have no choice but to seek humble refuge here. But despite the desperation, all sorts of lofty demands for silken sheets and finest fruits. But we can't grumble about it too much. After all, they are always willing to pay a fair price for their luxuries. I just wish they didn't have to be so superior about it. You're my favorite sort of guest to have, by far. Respectful, unassuming, keeps to themselves, but is always willing to share a story or two over a drink. Speaking of, I've been so rudely neglecting my barkeeping duties. What would you like? If you aren't craving anything in particular, there, I do actually have a recommendation. Sparkling blood luck berry wine from the holidays. Very rare and expensive, so our reserves were quickly depleted by New Year's. But I was sure to hide away the very last bottle until you returned, so you could have a taste. Just got to find the key. Couldn't be just any old hiding spot. You have no idea how mad the elves go for this stuff, and they can sniff it out better than you'd believe. Here we are. My precious. Was so proud of this one. As soon as she first concocted it, she ran halfway here from the moss drop in the pouring rain until she hopped onto the back of a passing carriage to ride the rest of the way. The passengers were having none of it and tried swatting the snow away off with their coats, but to no avail. That woman has a strong resolve and an even stronger grip. Once she's decided, she's itching. Not even a dragon could pry her loose. So she finally arrived here, dripping wet, splattered in mud, hair in even more of a dizzied whirl than usual, and with a few new enemies. She was frantically pounding on the door, shouting, "Bridgie, Bridgie, I've boiled pure peach cobbler into a cup. You must try it at once." And she was exactly right. I swear. You know, she's always been incredibly persistent with her matchmaking escapades, but lately she's especially had her sights set on pairing me up with the cobbler. So I think that this peach cobbler tea is a subtly not-so-subtle nudge. After all, the magic touch she's added to it is that your shoes will shine like stars. Yeah, she's been fabricating the most pointless errands for me just because they'll take me by his shop. He's clearly far more interested in the blacksmith, if you know what I mean. But she's relentless. To be honest, I think she just wants a guaranteed future of custom-made shoes out of the deal. Anyway, looks like the fire's getting a bit hungry. Let's give it a snack. Looks like a decent slice. That'll do the trick. Good. Back to working on that jacket. There's still so very much to do. Oh, but Pippet Whistle does remind me of one tidbit I can offer you about the nobility. When it comes to nobles, every the key to which way you mean it in that moment lies entirely that is considered an incredibly brazen show of dominance to dare compliment someone who you are seated at a table with as they cannot see your feet and unable to know your true intentions. I learned that lesson the hard way when I was having my Sunday morning tea and biscuits at the mouse drop, and the most piercing emerald eyes, willowy, statuesque, that crisp click, clack, click, clack, click, clack of her heels announces her entrance without her needing to say a word. Just hypnotizing. But Pippet Whistle hasn't opened shop for the day yet. This woman is having absolutely none of it. In true noble fashion, she's going to be served, and that is that. I was a touch concerned by how quickly Pippet Whistle changed her tune and eagerly agreed to serve her. I've only ever known her to have no time for the prissy, demanding sort. She flashes me a mischievous wink. The noble woman sits herself at my table and gives me this sharp-eyed once-over that is absolutely dripping with judgment. I can't imagine she was particularly impressed by my uncurled hair and decidedly unrefined dress. I break the silence by telling her as if I had just tossed my cup of tea into her face and then dumped the rest of the pot over her head. Pippet Whistle comes bustling back out with the widest grin on her face, proudly serves her a steaming cup of honey vanilla tea with a slice of strawberry cake. And as I'm sure you've already surmised, it was no ordinary slice of cake. No. She had generously coated the frosting with illusionist dust, so that for the rest of the day, every time this lady saw her reflection, she would see herself as completely bald. Her actual hair wouldn't be compromised in any way, but she would get quite the fright, I'd imagine. Yes, I'm there every week. I have Sundays off from the inn, and I'm up before sunrise, so I can make the very most of the day. I put on my favorite sundress and wear my hair down if it's nice out, or tied back with a ribbon if it's windy, and walk over to the moss drop to have tea and breakfast with Pippet Whistle before she opens shop. Then I wander around town, visiting the shop. Trying on big coats and feathered hats and silky gowns. And then it's down to the forest to spend the afternoon collecting anything interesting that catches my eye, you know, mushrooms, flowers, herbs. Don't mention it to anyone, but I do have a favorite waterfall that's perfect to sit by and enjoy any berries you might have found along the way. It's a secret. There's a well-worn tunnel going through the bushes. It was made by creatures, so it's quite isn't hard to get through if you sort of crouch and shimmy your way through. It's not one of those grand roaring falls, but more of an understatement. Bella knows that it's my Sunday afternoon spot, so every once in a while she'll appear there to sit with me for a bit. Always with a rough bristle brush tucked away in her pocket. Well, she knows that when I'm weaseling my way through the thickets, I never fail to get a mess. So she'll make it tidy back up. She scolds me for being too reckless in the forest, but she's one to talk, don't you think? And you know what they say, falling down a hill is just a shortcut to mushrooms. Bella likes to say, "Agrimar, one of these days you'll just keep tumbling and tumbling all the way to Grenfleur." Oh, she calls me Agrimar because, you know, Agrimar Bridget. She knows I hate it, and that makes it all the more amusing to her. Anyway, I like to stay there by the waterfall, listening to the wind rustling the leaves, watching the birds and the butterflies fluttering past, until the sun starts to set. By the time I'm walking the trail back to Babblebrook, it's golden hour. Everything is enveloped in that warm, rosy glow. Passing carriages are bringing people home from a hard day's work in Arbington, back up to their cottages in the hills. For supper, throw together a soup. Tomato and basil with sourdough bread is my absolute favorite. Then it's time to bundle myself in blankets. Sit by the fire with pepper purring away in my lap and a mug of cider at my side. And that Unfortunately, this is the best work I can manage. I think this outer coat might have to begin its new life as an undercoat. It'll still keep you warm, but certainly will not be impressing anyone. Put that here for you. Right. If you have it handy, thank you.
rain out there, huh? So nice. Well, I know you already have more than enough to handle, but Mabel did make me promise I would make just one little request of you, if you don't mind. Great. Well, you see, on your journey, you will be passing through the northern reaches of the Penrith Forest, where the Glenham Cliffs meet the Mainquad Meadows, which is the one and only territory of the ancient Fablegrog beetle. She's absolutely desperate to get her hands on one. She spent 2 days filling up an entire book full of sketches of the Fablegrog, just so that she could be sure to provide you with her very finest and most accurately representative work. So she's included this cage, of course, for your find. And then as for the sketch, so here's her illustration of the beetle. Upon that particular beetle, she said that in its place, a very good pebble will suffice as a travel token. I'm not sure what exactly constitutes a very good pebble, but I'm sure your instincts will guide you. Let's see. Oh, I nearly forgot. I've been meaning to. If you would like this hat, by any chance. I know it's out of the blue, but someone left it behind. I was hoping they might return for it. Sadly not. I found it when I was cleaning up after the needlings. I thought this color would look lovely on you. What do you think? I think so too. I'd also like to put together a parcel of food for you to bring along. I'm sure the witches just about nourishment, is it? No. When you're out there in the depths of the forest, I'll feel much better. Not to assume the worst. I hope there's just a change of plans, perhaps a fallen tree or overrun stream forced them to alter their route through the mountains instead of past our weekend. It's not rare for things like that to happen. Well, let's see. What sort of bread is your favorite? We have supposed to be nearly springtime, but not quite. All good things in time and all that, I guess. You should feel incredibly special. Fireside blanket. There's none better. Right. Perfect. Now then, Mrs. Pippet Whistle's most adored spoon seems to have gone mysteriously missing, so I'll be whittling up a new one for her tonight. You're more than welcome to just sit there by the fire. Let me know if I can get you anything else, alright? Alright. Starting off with just a simple block of wood. It's exciting to watch it take shape into something different entirely. A particular sort of excitement, I suppose. A very, very slow-paced sort. But excitement nonetheless. Thank you for spending some time with me. It's always a pleasure. I hope you'll sleep well. And if I don't see you again,